Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship here at North Decatur United Methodist Church. My name is Connor Felty. I'm an intern for adult discipleship here, and I am so glad to be in worship with all of you. A couple of announcements before we get started. We have a lot to be excited about here at North Decatur. First, our spiritual director in residence, Kimberly Broerman, is going to be leading a series through starting April 18th and running through June of spiritual direction gatherings in a group. On April 13th, our North Decatur youth will be visiting the disaster response warehouse and helping to prepare supplies there. On the weekend of Earth Day, we have a lot going on. So on Saturday, April 20th, SAND is having their annual plant sale from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. And then on Sunday, the Green Team will be here. A couple of other announcements, and then I'll invite some guests for some other things. Tomorrow's Monday, that's how time works. Tomorrow, we have our blood drive, our monthly blood drive here at North Decatur. What are the times for that, Charles?
2 to 7?
2 to 7 p.m. And also, there is a resource for guided prayer around the United Methodist General Conference that is put together by the Upper Room, and that is accessible on our website. You go to the church website overall, then the Growing in Faith section, and then the Daily Faith Practices. And so if you go to that webpage, there's 40 days of prayer for this very important gathering of our entire global church. Now I want to invite Matt Woodruff up to make an announcement about our upcoming church council meeting.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Everyone hear me without a microphone?
Yep.
No.
All right, we're going to do this anyway.
All right. So, my name is Matt Woodruff. I am the council chair here at NDUMC. I told you about 6 weeks ago that one of our goals as a council is to make sure that the folks in the congregation know what the council is up to, and therefore what the congregation is up to, sort of from a broad perspective. So, you may have noticed that I did not get up here last month. It was decided that the council meeting in or around Holy Week was probably not the right thing to do. So we had decided to push our March council meeting back to April 11th. So those of you that would like to attend, it is April 11th at 7:30. We had some exciting things go on in the last council meeting. Two budgets needed to be approved. Every year, council approves the church budget as well as the SAND budget. For those of you that don't know, SAND is the preschool associated with North Decatur United Methodist. So we approved both of those budgets with new line items for the care team, which we're looking forward to hearing from soon from the council, as well as a new line item to help support folks in our congregation through the ordination process. So those were the two main discussion points there. In addition, for those of you that don't know, SAND has been involved for a while now in the provision of free food, both to Decatur Cooperative Ministries, as well as the free fridge, I think. We are actually going to be establishing an orchard on the NDUMC campus through funds donated generously by Catherine Lunsford. We're actually going to be naming it the Catherine Lunsford Memorial Orchard. So this past year in 2023, 800 pounds of free food was given to those organizations. They expect that to increase significantly in 2024. They think 6,000 pounds potentially, and we hope to keep that going. So hopefully we can have that on NDUMC's campus and really help that continue to grow. Two last things. This upcoming council meeting, we're very excited to be discussing a solar project here at NDUMC. There's been a talk for a long time about essentially making this church fully, well, we'll see about fully. We'll discuss it. But we've got a really exciting solar project that we're going to be discussing. If you want to be a part of it, please do come and listen in. And lastly, I mentioned a couple weeks ago, we have a block party coming up. Ashley is going to be heading that. Please do contact either myself or Ashley. We will be looking for contact information in the newsletter, so keep on the lookout for that. Thank you all, and we'll see you next month.
Testing. Thank you so much, Matt. I'm just here to, I'm the lead of the green team. If I haven't met you, my name is Keaton. So excited all the stuff that we're doing this month, connecting with Stan, connecting with the community. First thing I'll say is we have a 5-part Spring Earth series coming. A week from Wednesday is the first speaker, and from 7 to 8, the first speaker is the commissioner of DeKalb County, Ted Terry. So be looking out for that. The festival we're having on the 21st is called the Let There Be Light Festival. We're really excited. It's gonna be kind of connected with Sand. Sand's gonna be showing us a tour of the property, talking about this living orchard that we already kind of have that even as a Greens member, I didn't know about. So I'm really excited. We're gonna tour the property inside and outside. We're planning on getting a bunch of people together and planting blueberry bushes to continue to be part of that like living orchard experience. Bring any hard to recycle things with you. We're gonna take a big truckload of hard to recycle things to Charm, and we're gonna be decorating some little mini plants for the kids, or mini plant pots for the kids, and cleaning up the property and just having a connection with Earth and feeling some agency with that. Thank you so much.
There are so many ways to be part of our vibrant community, and we celebrate that and are grateful to speak those things here in our service. And yet, we're gathered here in this moment, not for announcements and news flashes, but to connect with the living and present and resurrected God. And so I want to invite you to feel the weight of your body in the pew under you, to settle in and take a deep breath, and to join me in our call to worship, printed in your bulletins, or it can be found on the screens. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
As the Father sent Christ, so Christ sends us.
May His Spirit lead us to greatness.
Let us seek the Lord our God.
Let us worship Christ.
Now, please stand and join in our first hymn of praise, Crown Him with Many Crowns. It's number 327 in the United Methodist Hymnal, or the words can be found on the screen.
Thank you.
Please join me in saying our North Decatur Creed. Our congregation wrote this creed together in 2019, and now we affirm our faith with the historic Christian tradition and with our own concerns and experiences in mind. Do you believe in God?
I believe in the triune God, who creates all things and calls them good. Even when loving or trusting God is hard, God provides for us. Even when loving or trusting ourselves is hard, God loves us as we are.
Do you believe in Christ?
I believe in the incarnation of God through Jesus Christ. Even when humanity seems hopelessly flawed, Christ becomes human in Jesus, the Son of Mary. Jesus lived among us, broke bread with us, taught us, and healed us. Jesus was crucified by those in power and rejected by his closest friends. Jesus overcame the power of sin and death to draw us to resurrection alongside him.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, who enlivens us and sustains all creation. Even when we are brokenhearted and the way ahead seems unsure, the Spirit of God comforts us and directs us. Even when pride discourages our curiosity, the Spirit invites us into mystery.
How is this known among us?
God is known among us as we read Scripture, attune to the traditions of the faithful, ask big questions, and experience God's presence in new ways through community and solitude. We trust that God works through us to transform the world through love and service. God is with us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
You may be seated.
My name is Art Edwards. Joyce and I have been attending here for about a year and a half, and it's good to stand here and actually be able to see all of you, which we can't usually do sitting in the pew. I was also very happy, Matt, to hear your announcement that the church is looking into tying into the sun more completely. Seems like a good idea. Prayers for me are a time of context, straightening out my mind and trying to get it to go somewhere. No easy task. And this morning when I woke up, I thought, anyone who's here today, who's in their early to mid 40s, I want you to consider the fact that I've been doing prayers like this since before your parents were born. So thank you for listening. And now let us go to God in prayer. We give thanks, O God.
For your steadfast love endures forever.
Good morning, God. Here we are, some of your people from North Decatur United Methodist Church. We're wondering and wandering. We're waiting and wishing. We're wounded and whole. We've come today hoping to find faith in the name of love. And we have a prayerful question for you. What are we doing here? We live in a badly broken world. Hunger stalks children from Eagle Pass to Eritrea, from Rafah to Ramallah, from Decatur to Dalton. These days we call hunger food insecurity, whatever we call it. Hunger hounds, hobbles, and hurts. So what are we doing sitting here rather than helping out where hunger is? Of course, our broken world has more problems than hunger. Our everyday lives are no piece of cake. We're baffled by perplexing personal relationships. While sitting here, we struggle with distrust, dysfunction, and denial. These aren't new dilemmas for the world or relationships. There are always more calls to arms than arms to respond. And yet we aren't without hope, ever. You've shown us a way from chaos to creation, but some mornings it's hard to roll out of bed. Exhausting to put one foot in front of the other. Mind numbing, staring down our unforgiving to-do list. And while fretting, we're becoming rocking chair people, forever moving and never going anywhere. Right now, instead of doing, we're here rocking away, catching our breath, and being. But maybe that's okay. A kite can't soar unless it's tethered to the earth. Maybe we can't engage the world or heal relationships until we connect to the ground of our being, you. Maybe that's the point of being in a sanctuary. Maybe we're not here to do, but to be, to connect, to discover, to be awestruck, to bathe in the spirit, to see with new eyes. Maybe this is a time to touch the ineffable, to accept the unknowable, to be awestruck by the holy, to become gobsmacked. Maybe we're not here to answer a call to arms, but to linger on a path to peace. Maybe now is our time to be still beside still waters, listening for your still, small voice. Grant that in good time, your being will empower us to do your will, even where hunger know us, and we hope our strength and love might make even the tiniest difference in our broken world and to our roller coaster relationships. Help us seize our time for doing when it arrives. May we begin by doing the tiniest things for the beings around us. In this moment, tether us to the peace that comes from your presence. Ground us so we can soar, fill up our tanks so we can give it the gas. And as we balance between doing and being, grant us a peace that passes all understanding in every season of our lives. Dearest God, during this time of rest, surround us with hope so we can find sustaining faith in your everlasting love. We ask this in all your holy names, and we give thanks, O God. Amen.
It's time!
Thank you.
Friends? Corona, did you hear? Where are my friends? Oh! I was about to say all my friends are out there, but okay. It's so good to see you all. Does anyone remember what last Sunday was? Was it
Patrick's Day?
not quite St. Patrick's Day, Asher, but I love the enthusiasm.
Easter.
That's right. It was Easter. And we talked about Jesus being raised from the dead, and that's so exciting. And we also said that we don't just celebrate Easter on one Sunday, but for many Sundays. And today is one of those Sundays. So I thought, you know, since we're celebrating, we could do something fun, like learn a song. How does that sound? Charlotte's ready to learn a song. Okay, so there's this part in the Bible. There's this guy named Paul. He writes a letter to some people and he says some very important things. One of the things he says is God's love is so deep and so wide, like a fountain flowing. And he wants people to know just how deep and wide God's love is. And friends, we have a song about how deep and wide God's love is. And there's some motion. So here.
We go deep. We go wide. And there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. And then we'll mix it up on you at one point. And we'll go wide and deep. Can you do, okay, so let's try.
I'm gonna try and hold this and do this at the same time. We're gonna see, okay. The song goes like this. Deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. Deep and wide, deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. Okay, we're mixing it up. Wide and deep, there's a fountain flowing wide and deep. Oh, I'm getting confused. Wide and deep, there's a fountain flowing wide and deep. Okay, now, this is where you gotta use your brains here, okay? This is the trickiest one. We're not gonna say wide and deep. We're gonna go and you have to remember where we are, okay? Can you do it? Yeah, we're gonna go deep and wide first, but I know, top level stuff. Okay, are you ready? There's a fountain flowing there's a fountain flowing there's a fountain flowing there's a fountain flowing Oh, friends, give yourself a pat on the back. That was good work. And so, friends, during Easter, this whole season of Easter, we celebrate just how deep and how wide God's love is for us. Can you pray with me, friends? Dear God, thank you so much for your deep and wide love for us. Amen. Okie dokie, friends, if you are coming with me to story time, now is that time.
You know, there's something to be said for motions to songs. That's all I'm saying. Our scripture reading this morning comes from John chapter 20. It was still the first day of the week, that evening, while the disciples were behind closed doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities. Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples saw the Lord, and they were filled with joy. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As my Father sent me, so I am sending you." And then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you don't forgive them, they aren't forgiven." Thomas, the one they called Didymus, one of the 12, wasn't with the disciples when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." He replied, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers in the wounds left by the nails and put my hand into his side, I won't believe." After 8 days, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. And even though the doors were locked, Jesus entered and stood among them, and he said, "Peace be with you." And he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. Look at my hands. Put your hand into my side. No more disbelief. Believe." Thomas responded to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus replied, "Do you believe because you see me? Happy are those who don't see and yet believe." Then Jesus did many other miraculous signs in his disciples' presence, signs that aren't recorded in this scroll, but things that are written so that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, God's Son, and that in believing you will have life in his name. The word of God for the people of God. If anyone gets a bad rap, it's Thomas. We even have a saying. We talk about doubting Thomases. Like, the whole definition of who Thomas is wrapped up in this one moment, this one reaction, this one chance that he has to be marked in history, and it is all that we remember about him. Tell me another thing about Thomas. It's hard to be defined by one moment, isn't it? And so often this happens to people. We remember one thing about one person, and we remember nothing else. And poor Thomas is stuck in this spot in our mind. And, well, if you'll permit me some spiritual imagination, which I have learned this year is an ancient discipline, if you'll permit me an opportunity to imagine for a moment what might be happening, maybe we can find a way to understand Thomas a little bit. Or at least maybe a way of understanding what is happening here with Thomas. It's always been my theory that Thomas was one of those people who is just dyed-in-the-wool practical person. You know, one of those people who looks around at everybody and says, "Well, what are we having for lunch?" One of those people who looks around and says, I see that we do not have enough beds for the people. We've got to figure out what's going to happen. Even if it's, 7:30 in the morning, they are ready to plan and care for everyone. One of those practical people who is like, "Okay, I know that we're supposed to be stuck in this room all day. But if we stay stuck in this room, none of us will eat, and nobody knows how long we will be here." My theory is always that Thomas was at the grocery store when Jesus appeared. Now, y'all, I know. It's not the grocery store he was at. He was probably at a market, or maybe he made some barters with some farmers, or maybe he went home to his mother's house. Who knows? But it's always my theory that Thomas was taking care of everybody else when Jesus finally showed up that day. For you see, it's still the first day of the week. The verses we read last week where we were at the tomb, these are the verses that come right after them. There is nothing in the middle. No time has passed at all. This is the first day when Jesus appears to the disciples. It's only someone who was truly practical and wanted to care for the whole of the community. That's the only person who would be out of this space at this time. And I am convinced that he was ready for the days and weeks ahead where they weren't going to be able to leave that space for fear of what might happen. Because Jerusalem had turned from a friendly place that we experienced on Palm Sunday to the hostile place that we experienced on Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday. The disciples are left not knowing quite what to do with themselves, and they have gathered in a room together. I'm sure some of the others are doing their part in the group, because, you know, in every group that gathers, we all wear our hat of what we are supposed to accomplish in that group. And we all know what our job is in any given group. Some of you are the treasurer. You know that money needs to be collected, and you know that you need to handle that piece. You also know that somebody has to keep the purse and pay the bills. That's someone's job. Some of you are the chief cook and bathroom cleaner because you understand that things have to happen and someone has to clean the bathrooms. And some of you are the planners. You are the dyed-in-the-wool practical people like Thomas that realize you need to plan ahead for tomorrow's food and tomorrow's lodging. And maybe what's going to happen down the line. But sometimes, when you're doing the thing that defines who you are, when you're doing your purpose and thing, you miss out on a visit from Jesus. You miss out on the opportunity to have the experience of the priests of Christ that these disciples who were gathered in that upper room that night experience. Jesus hasn't left them for more than a couple of days. The math is fuzzy. Don't ever try to do Bible math. It's a bad idea. And yet Jesus is returned and restored to them in this moment and offers them peace and breathes on them and offers them the Holy Spirit, fortifies them in the ways they need to be fortified for the road ahead. And Thomas misses out. Thomas misses it. And if you've ever been the one who missed something, maybe you will understand Thomas's reaction. This time of year always reminds me of a story of when my brothers and parents decided to go to the Caribbean without me. I didn't have the same spring break. They all had the same spring break. But in order to, as a cost-saving measure, they decided to drive to Tampa to fly out of Tampa instead of Atlanta. It sounded like a really good idea at the time, except for that the Final Four was in Tampa that year. There are glorious stories from my family about sleeping in the car at the Tampa airport. glorious stories about their eventual vacation, but the sleeping in the airport was the most exciting part for all of them. They love to tell the story of my parents, especially my dad, of how no one thought to look at where the Final Four was. I can tell you from the deep recesses of my soul that I still am not a happy camper about the fact that I didn't have the same spring break that week. That I missed out on that experience, whatever it was. I might not have even wanted to go, but I missed it. And anytime my brothers bring this up and start laughing about it at a family gathering, I have to remind my entire family that I was in school that week, and it must have been nice to sleep in the airport in Tampa. For you see, I think when we read this reaction from Thomas, maybe we should read this reaction with a little bit of, well, underlying anger, can we say that? With a little bit of frustration and annoyance. Maybe read sort of at that growly part of his voice, like, well, let's see if I can do it. Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers in the wounds left by the nails and put my hand in his side, I won't believe. Like anyone who is left out of someone, Thomas's reaction is to lash out just a little bit. Thomas's reaction is to say, whatever, like you've had a real experience. I'm not gonna believe. Whatever. It wasn't that great. Anything to make himself feel a little better about missing out on such an important moment for the disciples. An important moment of comfort that they had been offered by Jesus. An important moment that transforms everything. They even got the Holy Spirit, if you caught that. And Thomas misses all of this. So I'm not sure it's fair to call this doubt. I think instead we might see Thomas as just having a normal human reaction to missing out on experience that everyone else had around them. And there's nothing that hurts us any worse sometimes than feeling like we've been left out, a feeling like we're not important, a feeling like even what we have contributed is not important. Because let me tell you, this conversation probably took place while they were eating the food that Thomas brought in from the grocery store. Sometimes we concern ourselves so much with what we haven't experienced that others have that we fail to allow for ourselves to have our own experience. We reject completely and wholly. Instead of seeking to have our own experience with God. We call this doubt sometimes because doubt is an easier word than rejection. We call this doubt because doubt is an easier word than jealousy. We call this doubt Because sometimes as human beings, it's easier to reject the things that cannot be explained than it is to listen to those who have experienced them. And sometimes we're longing so deeply for our own experience that we lash out in anger at those who have experienced great things. I know you've heard stories like I have of people who have stories where they say, I was cured completely. You can insert whatever disease you want into that sentence. I was cured completely because people prayed for me. I was cured completely because I authentically sought God. I was cured because God's hand was in my life. Those stories are a fantastic testament to people's faith and understanding. They also are really annoying and frustrating. Because for every person who has a story like that, there are just as many people who said, I prayed really hard, and there was no cure. I prayed really hard for healing, and yet death came. I've always been faithful, and yet I'm still stuck in this place that I don't want to be. Those moments can sometimes lead to moments of what we're going to call doubt now. But maybe they are just like the moments from Thomas. Maybe they are moments of anger. Maybe they are moments of envy. Maybe there are moments of just frustration and annoyance that it didn't work out for you that day. Because faith is not just believing what we cannot see, but it's also about leaving open the opportunity for God to be present. The opportunity for us to see moments of healing when they seem very far away. When we open ourselves to the possibility that cures don't look the same for everybody. That the world can be transformed in many, many different ways. And that sometimes we're just waiting to see what God is going to do with us next. Waiting to see how the world can be transformed by our presence and in those moments. For you see, even Thomas, who doubted everything the disciples said and lashed out in anger pretty well, even Thomas got the moment that Thomas needed. A little while later, Jesus comes back and brings his peace and speaks directly to Thomas. And Thomas has a moment that nobody else gets, because he is singled out among the disciples and given the chance to put his hands in Jesus' side, to touch the place where the nails were, and to believe. The peace is offered to all of them again. But Thomas is the one who says to Jesus, my Lord and my God. Because even those moments of doubt, even those moments of anger, those moments of envy, those moments can be redeemed if we allow ourselves the opportunity to allow for God to be present. I often wonder who missed it the second time, who was out of the room, who wasn't present and now really has to hear the whole story from Thomas. Because the only way these stories happen is when someone shares the story. Doubt is a powerful thing, my friends. Sometimes we have a lot of fear about doubt, but doubt has the power to allow for us to believe. Because if we don't have doubt, there is no need for faith. And in our doubts, we have the power to transform the world. My hope is as you go from this place that you'll find a way to be a little bit more like Thomas. Maybe you'll say what you're really thinking sometimes. Maybe you'll be ready to care for the world around you like my imagination likes to believe Thomas was. Or maybe you'll just be ready to proclaim, "My Lord and my God." In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please join me in our prayer of confession, printed in your bulletins or on the screen. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the way of peace. Come into the brokenness of our lives and our land with your healing love. Help us to be willing to bow before you in true repentance and to bow to one another in real forgiveness. By the fire of your Holy Spirit, melt our hard hearts and consume the pride and prejudice which separate us. Fill us, O Lord, with your perfect love, which casts out our fear, and bind us together in that unity which you share with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. I now invite you, as forgiven and reconciled members of the body of Christ, to turn to your neighbor and offer signs of reconciliation and peace.
Thank you.
As we prepare for this morning's offering, please join me in a moment of prayer. Lord God, we thank you for the tremendous gifts you have given us. Show us that every good thing is a gift from above. Lord, as those who have received your gracious and abundant offering and blessing, let us now turn back all that we have to you, in possession, in time, in our whole being. We seek to glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen.
God will raise you up.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and brought us to the land flowing with milk and honey. And so set us before us the way of life. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your mercy, we have been born anew, a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead, an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Once we were no people, now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. Gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." On the day you raised him from the dead, he was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of the bread and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Your church has continued in the baking of bread and sharing of the cup. So in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heaven banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, through the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A few reminders. First, our method is that of intinction. We'll place a piece of bread in your hand, and you can dip it in the cup. If you would prefer, for any reason, especially if you need gluten-free, there are some small cups that will be here in the center, and you can come and pick those up as well. This is an open table, open to all. Those who believe fervently and completely, and those who are friend of Thomas and know all about doubt. Those who are young and those who are old, those who are members and those who are non-members, all are welcome at this table. Instructions on how to get to our stations. We have two stations up here, one in the back. Those few rows on this side in the back, someone will guide you and direct you to the station back there. And those of you in the balcony, somebody will help get you down when it is your time as well. If those who are going to serve me will come forward. Come and experience the grace of God. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Holy Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. Our closing hymn today is Be Thou My Vision, which in the hymnal is number 451. Let us stand and sing together. Go forth in peace this day, not with doubt, but with belief. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.